Welcome to our annual State of the Markets presentation. We are delighted to have you all here today and look forward to sharing some important information with you. I'd like to draw your attention to these disclosures. Please take a few moments to review them and let me know if you have any questions. Before we start, please remember to silence your cell phones. I'm here to help you better understand what happened in the markets in 2022 and what may unfold in 2023. If you have any questions during this presentation, please ask. You don't need to wait until the end. Chances are someone else is wondering the same thing, so if a question comes up, please ask away. Today's agenda. How did stocks perform in 2022? What drove market performance in 2022? And where are we now? What do major financial firms forecast for 2023? Let's begin with a look back at Wall Street analysts' initial predictions for the stock market's performance in 2022. How stocks actually performed in 2022, and some of the factors that drove that performance. The S&P 500 closed at 3,839.50 at the end of 2022, a decline of 19.44% and well short of even the least optimistic expectations of most Wall Street analysts. Few, if any, major financial firms anticipated the market's sharp drop from its historical high, which was posted on the first day of trading in 2022. It was a year of many surprises that forecasters simply did not anticipate. Two prominent examples of this were the Russian invasion of Ukraine and the unprecedented series of sharp interest rate hikes undertaken by the Fed. As you may recall, in 2021, the Fed suggested that inflation was transitory. Keyword there, right? Markets managed to cut some of the worst losses with the modest fourth quarter rebound, but it was a difficult year for investors in both stock and bond markets. Remember, the S&P 500 Composite Index is an unmanaged index that is generally considered representative of the U.S. stock market. Index performance is not indicative of the past performance of a particular investment, and individuals cannot invest directly in an index. Past performance does not guarantee future results. The return and principal value of stock prices will fluctuate as market conditions change, and shares, when sold, may be worth more or less than their original cost. So, also, forecasts are based on assumptions and subject to revisions over time. Financial, economic, political, and regulatory issues may cause the actual results to differ from the expectations expressed in the initial forecast. So let's talk about some of those factors that led to this. In the following slides, we'll discuss the factors that affected stocks over the year. As the chart shows, you can see a nearly year-long decline in stocks as represented by the S&P 500 index until a modest recovery in the fourth quarter. There is a saying on Wall Street, "Don't fight the Fed," which has never been more true than in 2022. Higher interest rates led to lower stock valuations as the Fed turned to a monetary tightening policy. And just as a reminder, the S&P 500 Composite Index is an unmanaged index that is generally considered representative of the U.S. stock market. Index performance is not indicative of past performance of a particular investment. Individuals cannot invest directly in an index, and past performance does not guarantee future results. The return and principal value of stock prices will fluctuate as market conditions change, and shares, when sold, may be worth more or less than their original cost. Now that that's out of the way, let's review some overarching themes that drove stock performance last year without going through each of these dates. As you can see from our first data point in January, inflation was already reaching levels not seen in many years. Inflation would accelerate from here and peak at 40 plus year record highs by mid-year before moderating, though remaining at historically high levels. In response, the Fed undertook an extraordinary series of steps to combat inflation, including raising its federal funds rate from near zero to over 4% in under a year. Matters were made worse by Russia's invasion of Ukraine in February, which, in addition to the human suffering and loss that it caused, created supply chain problems that led to higher fuel and food prices, which exacerbated the growing inflation pressures that were evident before the invasion. Recession was a major worry for all investors this year, as GDP growth, which was 6.9% in the fourth quarter of 2021, fell for two successive quarters before rebounding a bit in the third quarter. Stocks mounted recovery in the fourth quarter as investors began to believe that peak inflation and the bulk of rate hikes were behind them, and that any recession in 2023 would not be as deep or prolonged as earlier feared, so kind of like a soft landing for the Fed. This late-year rebound, however, stalled as recession concerns returned to the market in December. So let's talk about corporate earnings. Corporate earnings are one of the factors that drive stock prices over the long term. As the charts show, the earnings growth for the S&P 500 companies decelerated in 2022, though some analysts believe that they may trend higher in the second half of 2023. The S&P 500 Composite Index, again, is an unmanaged index of the 500 largest publicly traded companies in the U.S. Let's take a closer look. American businesses came roaring back from the pandemic, posting strong earnings growth in 2021 as consumers helped by multiple stimulus payments went on a spending spree as the economy reopened. The earnings growth rate also benefited from a favorable year-over-year comparative period. Earnings in 2020 were lower due to a national economic shutdown. Ironically, the 2022 earnings results were hurt by their comparison to 2021 surge in earnings, but that wasn't the only reason for a slowing growth rate. Inflation, it squeezed profit margins while consumers were left with less discretionary income after paying for higher priced food and energy costs. We already touched upon some of the economic numbers, but let's spend a little time getting a broader view of the economy in 2022. Economic growth contracted in the first half of the year, posting two consecutive quarters of negative GDP. The third quarter expansion came as a bit of a surprise to many economists, but it did show that the economy was proving resilient in the face of many challenges. The estimate of fourth quarter growth by the Atlanta Fed is 2.8%. The labor market was a bit of an economic surprise in 2022. With new jobs being added throughout the year, strong wage gains, and a steady unemployment rate. No one can overstate that inflation was the biggest economic issue last year, as the cost of nearly every consumer good and service rose. As you can see in the table, the inflation rate appears to moderate in the fourth quarter. A slowing economy coupled with high gas and food prices is a recipe for pessimistic consumer behavior. The table shows sentiment is quite low throughout the year. It's the lowest level was in the second quarter when gas prices were near their highs for the year. Finally, higher interest rates sent mortgage rates higher, making buying a home more expensive. This has reduced buyer interest and led to slowing home sales. The housing measure in this chart is a sentiment index of home builders. So, we've looked at some of the factors affecting market performance in 2022. Next, let's look at where we are now and examine the headwinds and tailwinds that could affect the direction of economic growth and financial markets in 2023. To create some context about where the economy stands today on various factors, let's start by examining where we stood in November of 2020. I picked this month as a reference point since it represents a moment in which the nation was finally emerging from the pandemic, though not completely out of it, and Americans went to the polls to vote in national elections. As the indicators suggest, the outlook for the next 3 to 6 months was mixed. The Federal Reserve's monetary policy was still accommodative, and interest rates sat at historic lows. Nevertheless, the economy appeared weak, hurt by consumer sentiment and the labor market. I want to draw your attention to inflation in the bottom left-hand corner. It still looked unthreatening at the time. Now, let's fast forward to November 2021. By then, nearly every measure to gauge economic prospects looked positive. There are no red indicators, and there are only three yellow indicators. From monetary policy to consumer spending, the prospects for the economy for the next 3 to 6 months looked encouraging. Remember, at this time, heavy fiscal spending was stimulating the economy. Also, the Federal Reserve had not yet pivoted toward hiking interest rates, and COVID fears were starting to ease. But, as we know, economic prospects were about to change. As you can see, there are no green indicators a year later. This stands in sharp contrast to a year ago when we saw 17 green indicators. Last year, there were no red indicators. Today, there are 7. Monetary policy remains tight, inflation remains elevated, and higher interest rates are dragging down the housing market. In a nutshell, the near-term economic prospects appear tepid, and if a recession develops in the first half of 2023, the depth and duration of it may turn on whether the Fed eases up on rate hikes. The labor market continues to be resilient, and consumer spending holds firm. Let's delve deeper into one of those speedometers, the leading economic index, or LEI, indicator. This index includes 10 components, ranging from stock prices to manufacturing orders. This data may give a clearer view of where we are, and when examined together, this chart shows the outlook trended lower throughout 2022. While no economic model is flawless, the data appears to support some forecasting of a recession in the first half of 2023. If you listen to my podcast, you would kind of be tracking with that thinking. It's important to remind people that past performance may not lead to future direction, but as we review charts like these, history can suggest where we are in the economic cycle. It's also important to remember that forecasts are based on assumptions and subject to revisions over time. Financial, economic, political, and regulatory issues may cause the actual results to differ from the expectations as you see them expressed here. From the leading economic indicators and the economic speedometers we just reviewed, it's clear that 2023, the economy may face some challenges. The first headwind facing the markets is inflation and rising bond yields. Both can hurt businesses. Inflation can make consumers less likely to spend on certain items, while higher bond yields increase business investment costs, reducing profits. So inflation remains above the Fed's target of 2%. But the good news is inflation is trended lower in the fourth quarter of last year. If it continues its downward trend, it may give the Fed room to ease up on the size and pace of future interest rate hikes. That leads to our next potential market headwind, a recession. As the Fed tightened monetary policy, the drumbeat of recession fears increased. Finally, geopolitical tensions are a potential headwind. Headline examples include the ongoing conflict between Ukraine and Russia and China's threats towards Taiwan. But it's worth remembering that it's often the geopolitical event that no one anticipated that surprises the markets. While the headwinds facing stocks are not to be underestimated, there are several potential tailwinds that may support the financial markets in 2023. In the final months of 2022, consumer price increases started trending lower. Falling inflation may boost consumer spending, which in turn could help corporate profits. Moderating inflation, as I just mentioned, may also give the Fed room to ease up or even pause on interest rate hikes in the year ahead. While inflation remains above the Fed's 2% target rate, fresh evidence of a downward trend may set the stage for a more dovish monetary policy. One result of higher interest rates in 2022 was a rally in the U.S. dollar. A stronger U.S. dollar hurt some multinational companies that generate part of their revenues overseas. Should the dollar weaken in 2023, it may help the bottom line for some companies. The cycle of higher interest rates may be closer to an end than the beginning. This would be welcomed news to the financial markets. Finally, some will keep watching China, the world's second largest economy. With China's exit from its zero COVID lockdown policy, a more open China may herald a return to greater reliability to the global supply chains and a reinvigorated demand from Chinese consumers, which may provide a welcome boost to global economics. I saw some data today that shows a lot of consensus estimates that China's GDP is to grow at nearly 6%. Before discussing the 2023 forecast, let's examine this chart to see where stock prices trend against historical averages. The most common way to do this is to look at the PE, or the price to earnings ratio, which measures what investors are willing to pay for a company's earnings. Looking at the dotted line in the middle, you can see that the PE for the last 25 years is, on average, 16.84. You can also see that the PE moves quite a bit, with a peak near 1999 and a trough near 2008. The chart shows that the PE was 15.15 on September 30th, 2022. Does that mean that stock prices will head lower or climb in the months ahead? It's difficult to answer, but it's fair to say that past performance does not guarantee future results, and the future and return and principal value of stock prices will fluctuate as market conditions change. We've talked about what impacted markets over 2022 and what may impact markets in 2023. Now let's see what financial professionals have to say about where they think the market is headed in the context of a more detailed discussion of some of the possible headwinds and tailwinds we just finished reviewing. The share of gross domestic product, or GDP, that comes from consumer spending is just a shade under 70%, which makes the financial health of the American consumer essential to economic growth. One of the reasons for the strong corporate earnings in 2021 was an excess of savings. So that's the consumer savings levels above the norm define excess. That's the definition. So these excess savings, which were built throughout 2020 in the pandemic, were aided in large part by fiscal support, which is individual stimulus payments that I'm referencing, and reduced consumption, so not spending as much. As the chart on the left indicates, those savings started to draw down as Americans resumed spending with the economy reopening in 2021. However, as you can see from the chart on the right, these excess savings started to trend lower in the third quarter of 2021. These excesses, or excess savings, may help provide some of the consumer spending that helps keep the economy from entering a recession. But that may only be the case if the labor market remains healthy and consumers stay confident about their financial prospects, so their future prospects in the job market. Corporate earnings may be another driver of stock market performance in 2023. According to FactSet, a leading financial data and analytics firm, you can see that earnings are expected to trend slightly higher in 2023 after an up and down 2021 and the first half of 2022. Estimating quarterly earnings is difficult, but such estimates can help guide decisions about what price to pay for a stock. If earnings are healthy, it may support higher prices. Conversely, should earnings come in short of expectations, it may put downward pressure on stock prices. It's important to remember that forecasts or forward-looking statements are based on assumptions, subject to revision without notice, and may not actually materialize. And if we've learned anything during the past couple of years, the outlook for financial markets can change quickly. The course of stock prices in 2023 may be correlated to the path of interest rates in the year ahead. One tool traders look to understand where rates may be heading is the CME FedWatch tool, which analyzes the probabilities of future target rates, as implied by the 30-day Fed funds future pricing data. If we look at where the market thinks the Fed is going, we see that the market believes there's almost a 50% probability of the federal funds rate increasing from 4.75% to 5% by June end. At the end of 2022, the Fed funds rate is 4.25% to 4.5%. Traders also price in a 22% probability for a 25 basis point increase in the first 6 months of 2023. There's a 26% probability attached to a 75 basis point increase over the time period. Keep in mind, the CME Group's table changes on a daily basis and probabilities are based on assumptions and are subject to revisions. Financial, economic, political, and regulatory issues may cause the actual results to differ from the expectations expressed in the table, and the data and output from this tool does not constitute investment advice and is not a personal recommendation from CME Group. Economic forecasters surveyed by the Philadelphia Fed in the fourth quarter updated their outlook for Q4 2022 and all of 2023. They reduced their expectations for GDP growth, lowering their earlier estimates in each of the next several quarters. They do see a rebound in economic growth in the fourth quarter of 2022, however. What's interesting is their unemployment rate projections have stayed mostly unchanged through the first half of 2023 with a slight uptick toward year end. It would be reasonable to think that a sluggish economy might influence the unemployment rate, but that may not be the case. We'll discuss the possible reasons for why that split in the next slide. I've said this before, it's important to remember that forecasts are based on assumptions and subject to revisions over time, and financial, economic, political, and regulatory issues may cause the actual results to differ from the expectations expressed in the forecast. Despite a softening economy in 2022, the labor market was remarkably resilient. The series of charts we're looking at examines JOLTS data, JOLTS or Job Openings and Labor Turnover Survey. JOLTS is a monthly government report that examines the state of the job market from the perspective of current job openings and turnover. Let's first look at the chart on the left, which indicates the ratio of the number of job openings to the number of unemployed workers. Coming out of the pandemic, the number of job openings rose as businesses looked to hire staff to meet demand. Now turn your eye to the upper right chart. That rise in JOLTS quits is what many called the Great Resignation. Following the pandemic, many people reevaluated their lives and jobs, leading many to quit for a new career or drop out of the workforce entirely. YOLO, right? You only live once. Finally, the lower right-hand chart shows the trend in JOLTS layoffs, which after a pandemic-related spike has trended lower. So what are the major financial firms forecasting for domestic stock prices in 2023? After a difficult year, forecasters are a bit downbeat about the prospects for 2023. As you can see, some of the firms are projecting a year-end close on the S&P 500 not far from the market's 2022 close of 3,839. And as of today, We're sitting right at 4,000 on the S&P 500, and today is January 16th, 2023. So, of course, you know, no one knows for sure what equities will do in 2023, and predictions at this stage are just that. They're predictions. Like other images in this presentation, this image includes a forecast. So it's important to remember that forecasts are based on assumptions and are subject to revisions over time. Financial, economic, political, regulatory, and in this instance, health issues may cause the actual results to differ from the expectations expressed in this forecast. We've covered a lot of information, focusing most of our discussion on what drove the market and what we expect to move the market over a short period. As this chart shows, the performance of a hypothetical 60% equity and 40% bond portfolio was down through the first three quarters of last year, with negative returns for both stocks and bonds. Our chart starts in 1977, and as you can see, it was the first time that both asset classes had losses. In this illustration, stocks are represented by the S&P 500 Composite Index, which again is an unmanaged index that is considered representative of the overall U.S. stock market. Bonds are represented by the Bloomberg Aggregate Bond Index. Index performance is not indicative of past performance of a particular investment. Past performance does not guarantee future results, and individuals cannot invest directly in an index. The return and principal value of stock prices will fluctuate as market conditions change, and shares when sold may be worth more or less than their original cost. What can you do in 2023 to move closer to your goals? Here are some action items for you. If your life or personal situation changes, keep us in the loop. We want to hear about important events like births and deaths. We also care about health issues, employment changes, and any financial developments that may change your situation. And if you find yourself thinking about new goals or reevaluating priorities, share your thoughts with us so we can help you pursue the life you most desire. On top of specific adjustments in your financial life, we also want to know how you feel about investment changes. These could be details like risk tolerance shifts or a market environment concern. Finally, remember to review your estate documents, beneficiary designations, and other paperwork to ensure they're all up to date. A well-organized estate is one of the best gifts that you can give your family. We're here to discuss any financial questions or worries you may have. Our priority is always to help you make informed choices and decisions to stay on track. Throughout 2023, we will focus on delivering the following. We'll keep you informed through regular communication. We'll manage your investments according to your personalized strategy, and we'll remain abreast of economic factors and adjust accordingly. We've gone through a lot of information here, and I'm sure many of you are still having lingering questions. Remember, if you're wondering something, there's an excellent chance that someone else is too. So how can I help? If you would like to send me an email, you certainly can. You can send me an email at info@northboundwealth.com, info@northboundwealth.com, and I'd be happy to answer any of the questions that you have. Whether it's investments, about it, maybe a investment review or the economy, or get some thoughts on financial planning. We're here to answer those questions for you, so feel free to send us an email again at info@northboundwealth.com. Another way to reach us is our direct line, which is 317-399-1107, 317-399-1107. Thanks so much for your time today. As you can tell, I'm passionate about helping you understand the markets. For more information and timely updates, please follow us on social media and contact us anytime. We hope that you enjoyed the details that we shared today, and I'm excited about what the future holds for Northbound Wealth Management and for you, my clients, and and or other listeners or followers of what we're doing here at Northbound Wealth Management. I do want to make an announcement. We do have a weekly podcast that's launched usually Monday or Tuesday every single week. It's called the Northbound Wealth Podcast. I'm your host. I go through the prior week's performance in the markets. Also, usually every quarter, I'll review the prior quarter to give a kind of a broader view of how the markets are acting and behaving and performing. And then also, I give some guidance in that podcast, whether it's short-term technical guidance or maybe some strategic asset allocation guidance as we navigate forecasting and looking at the next year to 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, and beyond. And I also include articles about retirement, Social Security, about millennial investing, early investing, retiring early, all kinds of different subject matter and context around financial planning and personal finance and investing. So hopefully you check that out, the Northbound Wealth Podcast. Also, social media on Twitter, our handle is NWM Espresso. So check that out. We're on Facebook as well and on LinkedIn and other social media platforms you can check out. Check out my blog on our website, which is www.northboundwealth.com, and sign up for the blog. We have a lot of content on the website that can definitely help you with calculators and tools and resources available to you as you're seeking out answers to your financial questions. So please reach us, 317-399-1107. Or shoot us an email at info@northboundwealth.com. info@northboundwealth.com.